Hello everyone, so I welcome you for this video lecture series on data communication. And in this lecture, this video lecture, we are going to take few exercises to understand better the concept of protocol layering and TCP/IP protocol suite. So let's take this first example. Assume a system uses 5 protocol layers. If the application program creates, 100 bytes, okay, and each layer, including 5th and the 1st, adds a header of 10 bytes to the data unit. What is the efficiency of the system? The efficiency is defined here. The ratio of application layer bytes to the number of bytes transmitted. So in this case, we are having 5 layers. Okay. And each of these, and the top layer, let's call that as an application layer, which is generating a data of 100 bytes, plus we are appending an adder. Okay, sorry, we are appending a header. So in the 5th also, we need to append. In the 1st and 5th, both we are appending an header of 10 bytes. Right? So the L1, along with the message which is of 100 bytes. So this is my message, which is of 100 bytes. And we are appending a header. So that will generate me 110 bytes. Now the L2 is having a data received from L1, which is of 110 bytes. And we are adding an header of 10 bytes again, which will result into 120 bytes of data that is generated by L2. Now L3 receives this 120 bytes of data from L2, and it adds its own header of, okay, okay, fine. So it adds its own header of 10 bytes. So now we have 130 bytes of data that is generated by L3. And L4 now has 130 bytes of data input, which adds another 10 bytes. Okay, so which will result 140 bytes. And then in L5, we have 140 bytes of data plus its own header, resulting into 150 bytes. So this is what we are having, the transmitted bytes. Right, whereas the data that is present here is what we can call as message bytes. So the efficiency is the ratio of the application layer bytes, that the message bytes that what we have, divided by the number of bytes we are transmitting. So this is 1 divided by 15, right? So if you represent that in terms of percentage, you will get around efficiency, which is of 6.6%. Fine. So what is the observation or remarks that we can give about these exercises? The appending of the header will reduce the efficiency of our transmission. So let's take another example. Now here we are taking the, we want to better understand the encapsulation and decapsulation in the TCP/IP protocol suite. So here we are taking the IP protocol and the transport layer protocol. It means when the IP protocol, let me read the problem. When the IP protocol decapsulates the transport layer protocol. So we have an IP here. And this will need to decapsulate the into either to the UDP, okay, or it has to send it to the TCP. So it is having a header. There is a message with the header. So let me call this as HIP. Okay, that is there at the IP. Now, how does it know? How does it know to which upper layer protocol the packet should be delivered? Okay, how does it know? We have to see that to which protocol it has to send, whether it has to send to the UDP or TCP. Okay, any idea? Think about it. I'll give you a few minutes. Okay. So let us recall what we have understood about these protocols. Every protocol is having an address, right? Sorry, every layer is having an address. Like we have here as what we call it as the IP address. And we have here what are, these are called as logical address also, right? So these are logical address. And we have here the port numbers, right? So how does the IP will decide? So from the header, it will identify to which port the message need to be delivered. So if the port is for the TCP/IP, so if I call this as port for TCP/IP, then the packet will be delivered to the TCP. If it is meant for UDP, so based upon the port address, the address for the logical address for the port, for the protocols, the packet will be delivered by the IP layer. Okay, hope you got this idea or the significance of addresses. So if the addresses were not there for the process that we have written, then it will be not be possible to deliver it to the right protocol, right? Okay, so let's take another example to see our understanding. So here the problem is like this. Assume that a private internet requires the message at the application layer to be encrypted and decrypted. So we have a message, right, that needs to be encrypted, let me call that as E. And we also need to do the decryption of the message. So both the encryption and decryption need to be done. Now, what do you mean by encryption and decryption? See, we are transforming a message in a simple terms. We are transforming a readable message into something which cannot be read. We call that as a ciphertext. So when I encrypt it, we call this as a ciphertext, which is not readable. And the process of decrypting is also called as deciphering. Right? So there are plenty of algorithms for this. And why do we do this? We do this That is because the two end devices, right, which are communicating, need to traverse through this unsecured network. Right? So devices are connected and we need to traverse. I mean, the data need to be traversed from A to B through this unsecured network. So we have to provide a security to the data. That is where this encryption and decryption process comes into picture. So they are the algorithm. Now, encryption is done in a very simple way, I can say that, because the those details you will be taking in the higher courses. So for encryption, we use what is called as a key. A key is used here, which will be agreed by both the parties, and the encryption and decryption process happens. So this is a very basic idea of the encryption and decryption or cryptographic methods. Okay, so if we need the problem, let us continue with the statement of the problem. If we need to add some information about the encryption decryption process, such as the algorithm. So some algorithms are there, we want to add some information. So when I'm sending a message, I want to add the information to the network, I mean to the users, to do some operation. The question is, does it mean that we are adding one more layer to the protocol suite? So what are the layers we have? So we have application layer, transport layer, network layer, data link layer, and physical layer, right? Okay, so do we need to add another layer? Let us see. Assume that, so this is what we are dealing is with the message, right? So it means at the application layer, the message is received. So once I receive this message, I can have one more layer here to do this encryption and decryption process. Okay, only encryption and decryption process is done in this layer, because that is what the problem is asking us to think of. Is it necessary? See, when we are talking about the layers, we talked about the various functions of the application layers, right? Like it is about file transfer, it is also about mail, about DNS. And there are very good specific operation functions of the transport, connection oriented, connection less service. Network layer, we are dealing with routing. Data link layer, we are dealing with the medium access and error. Whereas in the physical layer, we are dealing with signals, bits, transmission medium. So our operation of encryption does not fit in these four layers properly. The only one layer we can have either is to have a separate layer, or you can mix it with the application layer. If I take it as a separate layer, if I add one more layer, it means I'm adding more number of, I mean, I'm utilizing more number of resources. So it is better not to add a separate layer, but instead we can write it in an application layer. If we argue that we want to have a separate layer, then it should be written like this. So we have encryption layer. I will call this as security layer. Okay, because we are dealing with security. So then the transport layer, network layer, the next comes the data link layer and physical layer. Okay, so this is how we can redraw. So let us redraw that. So we can draw like this. See, if you argue that it is required, then only. If you are giving more functions, not just one, more functions, and they are unique, and somewhere we don't need to go with the application itself. Okay, so in that case, we can go with this layer, fourth layer called SL, and shift to the fifth layer as SL, and make the application layer as a sixth layer. So we have SL, transport layer, network layer, data link layer, and finally the physical layer. So this is where we can add. Okay, hope you get the idea of this. But think about it. Do we need a separate layer? Is it necessary? Okay, so let us take another example to see that what we have learned with the kind of protocol. So we are having three applications, a real-time multimedia, file transfer, and an email application. So which of these combinations is required? So TCP, let us first write down what is TCP. It is a connection-oriented. Right, and if you look at this, there is a what do you call accuracy, data accuracy constraint. So we need the data accuracy here, but delay is not a major constraint here. Delay not a constraint, not a major constraint. But accuracy is a constraint. Okay, so the reverse is true with the UDP protocol. It is a connectionless protocol, first of all, right? It is a connectionless oriented protocol. And delay is a constraint. Delay is a constraint. So delay constraint means where we, you know, delay is very important for us. We want it to be very quickly transferred. Whereas the data accuracy, the correctness in the data, is not so strictly constrained here. So real-time multimedia application. So let us see that. We have to understand that this is a delay constraint, right? Quickly we have to send the data. Okay, whereas it is not a data accuracy constraint. Okay, so it means that I will be using a UDP protocol. So I have two options here, option B and option C. So I'm going to use a UDP protocol. Now let's take the second one, file transfer. Here the delay is okay with us. We are not much bothered about the delay, whereas data constraint is there. We want the data to be received accurately. So yes, there are. In that case, we are going to talk about the TCP protocol. So again, B and C, both are there. Finally, the email. Email is again, it requires a connection node because there is an acknowledgement. That's what the connection-oriented protocol. Even the file transfer also, we need some sort of acknowledgement that the file has been transferred. Similarly with the email. So this is not a delay constraint. But the data accuracy is a constraint, right? We need to receive the email, the content of the email to be accurate. So in that case, we are talking about the TCP protocol in the email. So only this one will pop up. So the correct answer is option C. Okay. Let us continue with one more example. So protocol data unit, okay. What is a protocol data unit for the application layer in the internet stack? So here it is talking about the TCP/IP protocol. What is the data or the protocol data unit you call? Is it a segment or is it a datagram, a message or a frame? And you should also think how to justify your answer. So take a few minutes of time and answer it. So if I take segment, yes, segment appears in which layer? It appears in TCP layer. So the application layer is what is being asked. But TCP, in TCP we refer to this. So which appears in transport layer. It does not appear in the application layer. It is there in the transport layer. Now let's take datagram. So datagram, that is the user datagram protocol. And the other way, if you see, that is also appears in the IP layer. So it's also called as a packet, or you can use it in the UDP protocol also. So it is there in UDP. Okay. So or in IP also it can be used. So let's call that it is there. We are using the datagram word as per the definition in the textbook. So we are having also this in the transport layer. So this is also not a right answer. What about message? Yes, we see this PDU in application. Right? So message is a right answer. So the option C is the correct answer. But we are not attached with the frame. So frame is a protocol data unit in the data link. Okay, so that gives us an answer that the right answer is option C. Okay, hope you are following the exercises. Okay, now look at the problem, the another exercise. Which of the following transport layer protocol is used to support the electronic email? So just previous to the problem, I talked about the email. Now you select the option and justify. So there are four options we have: SMTP, IP, TCP, and UDP. What does the problem says? You have to select a transport layer protocol. So is SMTP a transport layer protocol? No, SMTP is a application layer protocol. So this is not a correct option. IP is a network layer protocol. It is also not the transport layer protocol. This is also a wrong option. TCP and UDP, both are transport layer. Okay, so the answer must be either of these two. To select it, we need to see what is electronic mail. Electronic mail is having a request and acknowledgement, right? So it means we are talking about a connection-oriented service. Right, we need to give it for a connection-oriented service. So which one is that? TCP/IP is a connection-oriented, whereas UDP is a connectionless service. Okay, let me write it. So it is a connection-oriented. Sorry. Whereas UDP is a connectionless service. Connection-oriented service and a connectionless service. So first of all, TCP and UDP are a transport layer protocol. Okay, we accept it. Then comes the second, that is electronic, which requires a connection-oriented service. Which is that? TCP. So the right option is option C. So what is the right answer? Is option C. So whereas UDP is a incorrect option. Why? Because the service required is a connectionless, connection-oriented service. But UDP gives us a connectionless service. So I will eliminate that option, selecting only option C. Now let's take this exam. Take some time and I'll wait for you. Let me pause for some time and I want you to think and solve this problem. Hope you have read the problem and understood its meaning. Now let me help you with it. So there are two notes. We have a source note and there is a destination. And two routers are there. That's what you say. Two intermediate routers. So this is how the network is connected. And we need to determine how many times each packet has to visit the network layer and the data link layer. Okay. So we have in the node application layer, whereas next is the transport layer, network layer, data link layer, and physical, correct? Whereas in case of routers, we just have network layer, data link layer, and physical layer. Similarly, in this router also, I have N, DL, network layer, data link layer, physical layer. And finally, here we have network layer, data link layer, physical layer. So we have transport layer, so the application layer. So how the data will flow? So it will flow from top layer to the bottom layer. It reaches to this first router, pass through up to network layer. From network layer, it comes back. Again, it will go to the next router. Network layer goes up to network layer and again comes back. And finally, it goes to the application. So let us see how this data has passed. So network layer once, data layer once. Again, it comes data layer second. Here it comes data link layer, network layer second time, data link layer third time. Comes here, the data link layer, fourth time, and we have here the third time for network layer, then the fifth time for the data link layer, again it passes to the data link layer, sixth time, network layer, or four times. So how many times the network layer has? One, two, three, and four. So we have options here, four. How many data link layer? One, two, three, four, five, and six. So where is that option? We have six here and here also. So where both the options are there? So it is there at option C. So the answer we see, we obtain is option C, right? Okay. Now, this is another problem we have. In internet, we have changed the LAN technology. So we are talking about, 1 minute. So we are talking about the LAN technology. Okay, let us write it somewhere. Which layers in the TCP/IP protocol need to be changed? So we are changing something with the LAN technology. So let us assume that this LAN technology is using a star topology to run. So we have a switch here. And there are machines that are connected. So we have machine one, machine two. Similarly, some N number of, so this N number should be small, so like 16, 24, something like that. So these are connected. One, two, three. Right, this is our simple LAN configuration. And we want to change the LAN technology. Something we want to change either with the cabling or with the switch itself, the new switch we want to buy. Replace that with a new switch. So which are the layers need to be changed? How do we answer? See, switch, if you recall about the topology, about the TCP/IP protocol suit we are discussing, Switch consists of the last bottom two layers. It consists of data link layer and physical layer. No other layers are considered. Whereas in your system, we have application layer, transport layer, network layer, data link layer, and physical layer. So if some changes are made in the LAN technology, right? Either we have to upgrade our data link layer and the physical layer. Some cabling we might change, or some error method we can change, right? Some medium access method we can change. So the only two layers that we are going to change is, now how did we decide only two layers? Because switch is made up of only two layers, whereas the router is having the network layer. So my correct option is, again here C. Oh, surprising, all my problems are having the same option. So this is option C. Okay. So that's it. I'll end these exercises on this chapter. Very interesting exercises were there. So thank you very much. See you in the next lecture.